If you're into sports, art, crypto, or the stock market, you've probably been hearing a lot about NFTs. With all this hype, we're entering into a time that feels oddly reminiscent of the late 90s and early 2000s. Tech is booming, the stock market is going to the moon, and Elon Musk is going to Mars. People are looking for pretty much anywhere to throw their money, and recently many people have been turning to NFTs. Leaning into that 90s, 2000s nostalgia, people are buying NFTs of Logan Paul's face on Pokemon cards, playing with crypto kitties like their Neopets, searching for digital art on sites that look like the days of DeviantArt, and paying $750,000 for pixel art that looks a lot like those custom cursors that people made in Microsoft Paint and put on every website in the 2000s. But wait, what the heck is an NFT? NFT stands for non-fungible token. To understand what this is, let's first break down this term. Something that is fungible in a very simple sense is something that can be traded for an equal and pretty much identical exchange of value. For example, if I have a $1 bill and you have a $1 bill, we can trade dollar bills and neither of us is going to care. It doesn't matter which of the physical dollar bills either of us has, it's still a dollar. Things that are non-fungible would be things like art, baseball cards, or your house. One art piece is not equal to every other art piece, and one house is not equal to every other house. If we try to trade those, that's not going to be an equal exchange of value. Even if we have the same asset, for example, the same trading card, it's unlikely that the value of those is going to be exactly the same. The value may depend on the condition, the placement of the print, or when each of our cards were actually produced. This exchange would not be equal either. With NFTs, we're talking about the same thing, but primarily with digital assets. So think things like digital art, upgrades and accessories in games, and even video clips of sports events. In the digital world, there hasn't been an easy way to prove ownership of something. You can save a JPEG off of Google and the file is just there, but you don't really own it. This is where the token part comes in. Think of a non-fungible token like a little digital authenticity certificate that verifies where the digital art came from, the past history and ownership, and yes, that it's real, and it can include anything else the artist wants to include in that NFT. With NFTs, all transactions take place on the blockchain. Oh gosh, what's blockchain? There are two main things that you need to know about blockchain when we're talking about NFTs. One, it's a way to keep a permanent record, and two, it can be added to, but it can't be altered. The information about or included with an NFT is going to be part of this chain. Many copies of this chain of information exist, and they all have to match. We can add information to this chain every time something happens. Maybe someone buys an NFT and it changes owners. That information is added across these chains, and if it all matches, then it's verified. But if someone tries to go back and change information, it doesn't work. If someone tries to change a piece of information, the rest of that chain will change too. When it's checked, the system will realize, hey, this one doesn't match the others, it was hacked or tampered with, and because it doesn't match all of those others, the info in this chain isn't actually valid. This lack of alterability is what makes it permanent. This isn't exactly how it works, but this is an overly simplified 30-second explanation of what's kind of going on behind the scenes. So the Ethereum blockchain is what is primarily used for buying and selling NFTs, and that's why you'll see that little E Ether symbol when you're looking through these marketplaces instead of seeing something like dollars or Bitcoin. With NBA Top Shot, Grimes, and Kings of Leon getting so much attention for their NFTs, you may be wondering, how did we get here? Well, the birth and explosion of NFTs started with colored coins. Colored coins were originally created on the Bitcoin blockchain. With colored coins, the goal was to create a token that was associated with something in the real world. Stocks, bonds, real estate, other currencies, etc. There were several flaws with colored coins, but the main problem was that the Bitcoin network wasn't really prepared to handle developers adding this extra layer yet. However, this did open up more exploration of the concept of NFTs. In 2015, Spells of Genesis became the first blockchain-based mobile game. It was a crossover between arcade-style games and a trading card game, and really put emphasis on the user accumulating in-game collectibles. It allowed you to buy their game assets on the blockchain, which really hadn't been seen before. Soon after, with this idea of owning a digital digital asset, the ability to buy rare Pepe memes emerged. Basically, you could go onto a marketplace, buy one of these memes, and technically you would own it. This happened around the same time that this whole NFT space started shifting over to the Ethereum blockchain. Moving from the Bitcoin blockchain to the Ethereum blockchain provided a more flexible base for developers to start building off of for people to be able to buy and sell NFTs. In other words, the Ethereum blockchain was better equipped to handle this extra layer being added on top of it. As the rare Pepe meme craze took off, CryptoPunks emerged, which were basically unique pixel art characters that you could own. This further expanded the idea of using NFTs for digital art. Then comes October of 2017, CryptoKitties. CryptoKitties are digital cats that you can buy, trade, and even breed. And these were the first NFTs to really gain mainstream media attention. The breeding of CryptoKitties created a new element in the NFT space. Essentially, if you owned two of these NFTs, you could breed them together and generate a third one-of-a-kind NFT. As CryptoKitties gained attention in mainstream media, the volume of Ethereum transactions skyrocketed and started majorly congesting the network. This meant that transactions were extremely slow. At the height of the CryptoKitty bubble, some people had to wait days for their transactions to actually go through. This ended up causing this CryptoKitty bubble to pop, and trading volumes eventually did return to more normal levels. But CryptoKitties are still around today. People are still buying and selling them. The team behind CryptoKitties, Dapper Labs, is actually the same team that is now behind NBA Top Shot, where you can buy digital basketball highlights. And honestly, going from selling digital Neopets-esque cats to getting a business contract with the NBA, that's a solid move. So other than buying sports highlights, what other applications could NFTs have? Well, another booming area is digital art. Traditional art has obviously been around and collected for centuries, but we've really never had a way to own or prove ownership of digital art. With marketplaces like Super Rare and OpenSea, you can now own art pieces from your favorite digital artists. Unlike traditional art, when an artist decides to make an NFT, they now have the option to earn money from future sales. If one collector buys the piece from the artist and another collector buys it from them, the artist can actually set a percentage of that sale that they'll receive. This allows them to continue to make money off of their pieces when they're bought and sold by different collectors. Recently, a piece from the artist Beeple sold for a record-breaking $69 million. So where's the value in all of this? If it comes with unlockables, for example, the source file with all of the painting's layers, I can definitely see the value in that. Some NFTs come with copyright or distribution rights. Others come with a physical limited edition print. Again, makes sense why people might be willing to pay for that. However, some people are just selling random JPEG or video files as NFTs, and as it stands, I personally think that the value of just selling a JPEG as an NFT is still a little bit questionable, but to each their own. Other areas where NFTs are gaining traction are the music and the film industries. Grimes has sold over $6 million in NFTs, mostly short videos with music, and Kings of Leon is releasing an album as an NFT, which includes a digital album download, and you can use it to redeem a physical limited edition vinyl. Piracy and bad deals with record labels and production studios have always been a major problem in music and films, and NFTs could provide a potential way to bypass the middleman, aka the labels and studios. This could give artists a greater potential to distribute music and films themselves, but we'll kind of just have to see how this plays out. Big companies like Nike are also trying to get in on the action. Nike has gotten a patent for CryptoKicks, or basically NFTs for shoes. They can be associated with an actual physical pair of shoes, and you'll have a digital version of it. Apparently, you'll also be able to breed your shoes. I guess someone at Nike was in on the original CryptoKitties craze, but another potential integration for Nike could be using these shoes in virtual games. So there are a lot of potential directions that NFTs could go in, but there are also some problems with NFTs. People have already written tons of articles on the potential environmental impact of NFTs, but I wanted to focus more on the logistics side. Owning an NFT essentially means that you own an official version of a digital piece, but what you can actually do with that is a little bit limited. The original artists still own the copyright and the distribution rights. This definitely is not legal advice in any capacity, but for digital art, that means you can't buy a bunch of NFTs and then go and open up your own physical store and sell prints of all those NFTs. You don't have the rights to redistribute that art unless those rights were specifically included in your NFT, which in many cases they're not. Same thing with music. You can't go buy NFTs of songs, have those made into records, and then go open up a record store. Again, you don't own the copyright or the distribution rights. That's nothing new. We're used to that with physical art and music from other platforms, but this also leads to some legal questions and issues that aren't exactly clear, especially regarding copyright and intellectual property. Some marketplaces, like SuperRare, go through a screening or vetting process of the artists they allow onto their platform. It's not open to any random person registering anything as an NFT. However, some platforms don't have a screening process at all, which is where the problem comes in. This can apply to any category of NFTs, but let's stick to digital art. If you draw digital fan art of Harry Potter or Thor, that's totally fine if you're keeping the art for yourself. But even though you drew it, you aren't actually supposed to resell it. They've copyrighted and trademarked the heck out of the Harry Potter and the Marvel universes, and those characters are most definitely intellectual property of their respective parent companies. So what do you do if you buy a fan art NFT and then the original artist gets in trouble for copyright infringement? How will that affect the NFT you bought? What happens if a person steals someone else's art or someone else's video clip and uploads it as their own NFT on a marketplace that doesn't have any sort of screening or acceptance process? On top of that, if we're talking about collectibles in this decentralized global marketplace, how and who actually enforces the copyrights, patents, and things of that nature? These are things that I actually want to know, so if anyone has any thoughts or articles on this stuff that they can drop in the comments, definitely go for it. So, what do you think? Is this the future of online art, music, and gaming? Is it completely stupid? Or are we just living in an episode of Black Mirror?